Good evening, everyone. I welcome all of you on behalf of Think India and Think India Travel Rights Forum. Think India is an organization of students from various national level institutes like IITs, IIMs, NLUs, NIMHANs that work for nation building and inculcating a nation first attitude among students. Think India has started with various forums, and the Tribal Rights Forum works for increasing awareness about tribal culture, about tribal rights, and taking great pride in the rich tribal heritage that our country inherits. Various initiatives have been started by the forum, like Shabri Ki Kutia, which daily posts certain tribal trivia, One Ke Jharo Ke Se, which was a podcast series that talked about unsung tribal heroes of the 1857 rebellion. Apart from this, we have also had tribal rights workshops and research paper writing competitions. Today, as part of the Ekalavya series of lectures, we are extremely honored to have one of India's most inspiring officers, Shri P. Narhari ji. Welcome, sir. It's an honor to introduce such a dynamic officer today. Apart from being one of India's most inspiring IS officers, sir is also an author and a lyricist. He started the famous Ladli Lakshmi Yojana, which went on to inspire several schemes along with the Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao. He has also played a crucial role in the revival of Chorli River, furthering the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan in Indore, and inspiring young athletes and students to realize their dreams. He has also played a crucial role in making Gwalior a disable-friendly city. He has written various books like Who Owns Maho and Making of Ladli Lakshmi Yojana. He has also penned the Ho Halla song, which was the Indore Swachhata anthem. Currently, sir is serving as the Managing Director, Madhya Pradesh State Cooperative Marketing Federation, Commissioner, Technical Education Department, Government of Madhya Pradesh, Bhopal. Sir, without any further delay, I would request you to share your opening remarks on today's topic, which is policies for tribal upliftment. Over to you, sir.
Thank you so much, Mrunmayee, for that wonderful introduction about me. I need to thank Think India Tribal Rights Forum and as a part of the Ekalavya series of these lectures that you have invited me to such a wonderful program. So first of all, thanking all the organizers. I also need to salute all the tribals of India for their immense contribution to the great culture of India. Their cultural values, their traditions, their customs inspire us a lot. The rich knowledge that they have about flora and fauna is what we all need to understand from the tribals of India. Having been a student of anthropology myself for the civil services, I have been able to actually study a lot on the tribals of India for the civil services. And now, as a practicing administrator, I come across a number of tribals as a part of the policy making and administration. I need to salute all the tribal leaders who participated in the freedom struggle of India, and we immensely remember their contribution, because of which we are able to freely live in this wonderful country. We cannot forget their contribution for the freedom struggle, and subsequently there have been many a number of tribal leaders who have been part of the post-independence India's development saga. I would like to mention here, as a practicing administrator and also a society member, a citizen of this country, that I have had several associations with many a number of tribals. I fondly remember I myself being from the erstwhile Karimnagar district of Telangana. I remember the tribe Erukala in my village. I always felt they are one of the most talented tribes in India, and their societal values and societal issues, their societal contribution is something I always cherish cherished as a child, and now I do see them growing up very well. During my preparation for the civil services, and then subsequently, another very rich tribe that I came across is the Lambadas of Telangana. And I have very good number of friends who have been a part of the civil services preparation. Lambadas or Banjaras of Telangana are one of the most educated, rich in culture. Their folk songs are something they echo in my mind. And apart from that, the way they dress themselves and their customary values that they have is something which we really have to appreciate. In Madhya Pradesh and also in Telangana, I have had the opportunity to interact with the Gonds. Gonds of the Adilabad district and Gonds of Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh, I feel are the ones where I have been able to really been able to come very close to. When I was assistant collector Chindwara, and then later on as CEO Zilla Panchayat Chindwara, and then as collector Sivni and Dindori districts, and later in Singrauli, I have had the opportunity to interact with the Gonds of Madhya Pradesh. They are one of the most important set of tribal people who are very, very close to nature. The way they protect wildlife is something we all need to really appreciate. Today, if in India, we have one of the most important tiger zones, and still many a number of tigers are alive in our country, I would say that it is because of the Gonds and their contribution to protect the wildlife in India. Gonds are also responsible, that's what I say, whether it is Kanha, whether it is Pench, Bandhavgarh, Satpura National Parks in Madhya Pradesh. Gonds are the ones who have played a very important role in the protection of the tigers. And one remarkable thing which I always felt while traveling in the rural areas of Madhya Pradesh and in Telangana, in the areas where Gonds live, if you happen to see their houses, they are one of them. They keep their houses very, very clean and neat. It looks like as if the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan emanated from the houses of the Gonds of India. Another important tribe that I would like to mention where I have had the opportunity to interact is Sahariyas. The Sahariyas of Madhya Pradesh are one of the most talented and very eager to learn. I have had the opportunity to actually work with these set of guys where in the tribal hostels, we had put them in the tribal hostels, and the Saharia kids were so talented. They were quick to learn, and we were able to post them in government jobs because there is a special provision for the primitive tribes of India. They need not actually take any examination in order to qualify for the government job. Sahariyas are one of the primitive tribes in India. Another tribe is similar of that kind is the Bhariyas. Bhariyas are the tribes who are found in Chindwara district of Madhya Pradesh, Chindwara, Betul, surrounding districts. And I have had the opportunity to interact with them. They are also another set of primitive tribes. And if you have heard about Patalkot in Madhya Pradesh, these primitive tribes of Bhariyas live in that area. And I would say that they are one of the most talented, like Sahariyas. The Bhils of the Malwa region of Madhya Pradesh are again another set of tribes where I had the opportunity to interact with, because I was collector Indore, municipal commissioner Indore, and the Bhils in the rural areas, especially of the Mau region, where I had the opportunity to work as subdivisional magistrate also, Their festivals are one of the most colorful festivals that I've come across. The Bhagoria festival is very well-known festival of the Bhils, and it is a tradition wherein a boy who wants to marry, I mean, has to choose his bride, and one of the most beautiful brides and well decorated bride is the one the boy picks up. And this Bhagoria festival is known for such rich traditions in Madhya Pradesh. So while talking about my own experiences about the tribes of India and the way their lifestyle and their growth and their contribution for the development of the society, I would like to mention here a substantial list of scheduled tribes in India are recognized as tribals under the Constitution of India. Tribal people constitute nearly about 8.6% of the nation's total population. That is over 104 million, that is 10.4 crores, according to the 2011 census. It is an officially acknowledged fact that tribals are the most underprivileged section of the society. And that's why the Atal Bihari Vajpayee government in 1999 has carved out a specific Ministry of Tribal Affairs from the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment to pay special emphasis and attention on the upliftment of tribal folks of the country. Chujol Oram was its first cabinet minister. Before the formation of the Ministry of Tribal Affairs, it was handled by different ministries, such as a division in the Ministry of Home Affairs known as Tribal Division, or Ministry of Welfare from September 1985 to May 1998. And the third ministry wherein the tribal affairs was looked after was Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment from May 1998 to September 1999. The Ministry of Tribal Affairs is the nodal ministry for overall policy planning and coordination of programs for development of the scheduled tribes. It covers all tribal people and all areas with tribal population across the country. This department functions as the umbrella unit for the scheduled tribes in India. However, the sectoral programs and schemes for the development of these communities, as well as their contribution, will fall under the ambit of concerned central ministries, departments, state governments, or union territories administration, where each ministry or department is responsible for its concerned sector. Till today, the ministry has undertaken activities that follow under the subjects allocated in the Government of India Allocation of Business Rules 1961 and amendments thereafter. The subjects allocated to the Ministry of Tribal Affairs are social security and social insurance to the scheduled tribes, tribal welfare, planning, project formulation, research, evaluation, statistics and training, promotion and development of voluntary efforts on tribal welfare, development of scheduled tribes and scheduled areas, and monitoring of scheduled welfare grants based on the framework and mechanism designed by Niti Aayog. Ministry has one commission, one public sector undertaking, and one cooperative society under its administrative control, namely National Commission for Scheduled Tribes, National Scheduled Tribes Finance and Development Corporation, Tribal Cooperative Marketing Federation of India. The National Commission for Scheduled Tribes is a constitutional body. Its functions are to report on the administration of scheduled areas and the welfare of the scheduled tribes, and to issue directions regarding the drawing up and execution of schemes essential for the welfare of the scheduled tribes in any state, to ensure the implementation of the Protection of Civil Rights Act 1955 and the Scheduled Castes and the Scheduled Tribes Prevention of Atrocities Act 1989. These are the functions where the National Commission for Scheduled Tribes has been designated with. The annual budget for Union Tribal Affairs Ministry is about 7,400 crores for the financial year 2020. 21. The tribal ministry has very important roles to play, and the programs and schemes of the ministry are intended to support and supplement the efforts primarily of other central ministries, the state governments, and partly of voluntary organizations via financial assistance and to fill critical gaps within institutions and programs, taking into account the situation of the scheduled tribes. The primary responsibility for promoting the interests of scheduled tribes rests with all the central ministries. The ministry supplements their efforts by way of various developmental interventions in critical sectors through specially tailored schemes. These schemes comprising of economic, educational, and social development through institution building are administered by the Ministry of Tribal Affairs and are implemented mainly by the state governments and union territories. There are very special safeguards provided to tribals in India, and this is very important in order to ensure that the tribals live in a peaceful and harmonious way in the Indian society. First and foremost, they have been given certain educational and cultural safeguards. The Hindu Marriage Act is not applicable to the members of the scheduled tribe. This is one such important provision. Article 15.4, special provisions for advancement of other backward classes, also includes the scheduled tribes. Article 29 protects the protection of interests of minorities, also includes the scheduled tribes. Article 46, the state shall promote with special care the educational and economic interests of the weaker sections of the people, and in particular of the scheduled castes and the scheduled tribes, and shall protect them from social injustice and all forms of exploitation. Article 350 gives the right to conserve distinct language, script, or culture, and this is applicable to the scheduled tribes of India. Article 350 also prescribes for instruction in mother tongue, and there have been several such efforts in several states, like the state of Madhya Pradesh has tried to teach the Gonds in their mother tongue, that is Gondi Bhasha. There are certain social safeguards. Article 23, prohibition of traffic in human beings and beggar and other similar forms of forced labor. Article 24, forbidding child labor. There are certain economic safeguards, where in Article 244, Clause 1, provisions of 5th schedule shall apply to the administration and control of the scheduled areas and scheduled tribes in any state other than the states of Assam, Meghalaya, Mizoram, and Tripura, which are covered under 6th schedule, under Clause 2 of this Article 244. Article 275 grants in aid to specified states covered under 5th and 6th schedules of the Constitution. There are certain political safeguards which are also provided under the Constitution of India. Article 164 provides for tribal affairs ministers in Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, and Orissa. I'll talk about this particular point later on. This is a very important section. Article 330 mentions about reservation of seats for scheduled tribes in Lok Sabha. Article 332 provides for reservation of seats for scheduled tribes in state legislatures. Article 334 talks about 10 years period for reservation, which has been amended several times. Article 243, reservation of seats in panchayats for scheduled tribes. Article 371 talks about special provisions in respect of northeastern states and Sikkim. 5th and 6th schedules of Indian Constitution, and apart from that, safeguards under various laws that include the Scheduled Castes and Scheduled Tribes Prevention of Atrocities Act 1989 and the rules thereafter, the Bonded Labor System Abolition Act of 1976 in respect of the Scheduled Tribes is also a safeguard for the scheduled tribes in India. The Child Labor Prohibition and Regulation Act of 1986. The state's acts and regulations concerning alienation and restoration of lands belonging to scheduled tribes. This point has come several times. I would like to mention here, like in Madhya Pradesh, under the Madhya Pradesh Land Revenue Code, without the permission of the district collector, a land belonging to any scheduled tribe cannot be alienated or sold off. And specifically, it has been mentioned that in case of the scheduled tribes, the lands, first of all, cannot be sold at all. And if at all, a land has to be sold, and it can be sold only from one scheduled tribe person to another scheduled tribe person only. So these kinds of safeguards are very, very important, because there have been several such instances where people belonging to the other castes other than the scheduled tribes have always tried to somehow manage to buy land by some way or the other, without actually properly informing the scheduled tribes. So there is a provision in the MP Land Revenue Code of Madhya Pradesh, and there are several such states which provide for a similar kind of provision, wherein until and unless the district collector actually gives the permission, the land of any tribal cannot be sold or alienated. The Forest Conservation Act of 1980 and the Forest Rights Act of 2006 also give a lot of powers, a lot of provides for the benefit of the scheduled tribes. The Panchayat Raj Extension of Scheduled Areas Act of 1996, the Minimum Wages Act of 1948, all have certain provisions for the scheduled tribes. There are various schemes, and I would like to mention some of them, wherein the education, for their education, there have been several scholarships that have been provided for. The livelihood, employment, and financial assistance for income enhancement. There are the several schemes, healthcare facilities, road connectivity in remote areas. The Ministry of Tribal Affairs implements the schemes for socioeconomic and educational development of scheduled tribes through state societies, voluntary organizations, NGOs, which supplements government efforts. And this is done through grants and aid to voluntary organizations working for the welfare of the scheduled tribes. Strengthening of education among scheduled tribe girls in low literacy districts is another such provision. There are several issues pertaining to problems that are faced by the tribes in India, which include loss of control over natural resources. This is time and again, there have been several issues which actually crop up, and we all read in the media about the alienation of the tribes from their very important natural resource. Lack of education, this is another such issue. Displacement and rehabilitation is the another important aspect. And as collector of Singrauli, I have had the opportunity to do major land acquisition for coal blocks for power projects in Singrauli districts. And I have always ensured, and I always tried as a district collector, not to alienate the tribals from their lands. And whenever there was a project which was coming up in tribal areas, we always tried to ensure that if the project can be shifted in such a way that the tribals, that we don't have to acquire the tribal lands. So this is something which the administrators have to do in order to ensure that the tribals are not alienated from their land and resources. There are problems of health and nutrition amongst the tribals. I'd like to mention here, like the Saharias of Madhya Pradesh, they are one of the most affected by malnutrition and tuberculosis. The prevalence of tuberculosis is one of the highest in the Saharias of Madhya Pradesh. If we look at the Gonds of the eastern Madhya Pradesh, we see that sickle cell anemia is another such disease which is highly prevalent. It is mostly I would say a congenital kind of thing, if I am right, that is highly prevalent in the Gonds of the eastern Madhya Pradesh. So the tribals face a number of issues. They possess small and uneconomical land holdings, because of which their crop yield is less, hence they remain chronically indebted. Only a small percentage of the population participates in occupational activities in the secondary and tertiary sectors. Literacy among tribals is very low. In 1961, it was just 18.53%. In 1991, it increased to only 29.6%, which compared to general literacy of 52.21% in the country. While the country has progressed a lot, the literacy rate amongst the tribals has been very minuscule. Though tribal literacy rate in Mizoram is 82.7%, and in Nagaland, Sikkim and Kerala, it is between 57% and 61%, lack of literacy among tribal people has been identified as a major development problem. A good portion of the land in tribal areas has been legally transferred to non-tribal. This is the issue I've been mentioning about. Tribals demand that this land should be returned to them. In fact, tribals had earlier enjoyed considerable freedom to use forests and hunt animals. Forests not only provide them materials to build their homes, but also give them fuel, herbal medicines for curing diseases, fruits, wild game, etc. Their religion makes them believe that many of their spirits live in trees and forests. This is something related to animism. Their folk tales often speak of the relations of human beings and the spirits. Because of such physical and emotional attachment to forests, tribals have reacted sharply to restrictions imposed by governments on their traditional rights. Tribal government programs have not significantly helped the tribals in raising their economic status somehow. The British policy had led to ruthless exploitation of the tribals in various ways, as it favored the zamindars, landlords, moneylenders, forest contractors, and excise officials and police officials. And we read there have been number of such instances, and we find a lot of freedom fighters who have always tried to point out these things and fight against the British at that point of time, and we revere them a lot. Banking facilities in the tribal areas are so inadequate that the tribals have to depend mainly on money lenders. Being miserably bogged down in indebtedness, tribals demand that agriculture indebtedness relief acts should be enacted so that they may get back their mortgaged land. Here I would like to mention that several governments have tried to give relief as far as indebtedness is concerned. For example, Madhya Pradesh government has recently come up with a law which says that if any money ever has been, any money lender has ever taken any, has given any money to the tribals in Madhya Pradesh, in fact, the tribals need not give that money, the money back to the money lenders. So this is actually in order to ensure that the gullible and easy nature of the tribals is often exploited by the money lenders. So in order to ensure that the tribals don't become pawns in the hands of the money lenders, these kind of relief has been provided by the state government, and this is very, very much needed. About 90% of the tribals are engaged in cultivation, and most of them are landless and practice shifting cultivation. They need to be helped in adopting new methods of cultivation. The unemployed and the underemployed want help in finding secondary sources of earning by developing animal husbandry, poultry farming, handloom weaving, and the handicraft sector. Most of the tribals live in sparsely populated hills, and communication in the tribal areas remain tough. The tribals therefore need to be protected against leading isolated life away from towns and cities through a network of new roads. Infrastructure, this is the most important thing, And we see in India, wherever there have been issues pertaining to extremism, or the Maoist forces, wherever they have been able to find place, are the inaccessible areas. Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Odisha, the northern parts of Telangana are all, this particular corridor is one of the most inaccessible areas and is lived by the tribals. So a very important thing that has to be done is to ensure that we have a very good network of roads, very good network of railways, and communication facilities actually have to be brought in. The tribals are exploited by a particular section, society, or a particular religion, where conversions is one of the major issues. In several tribal areas, mass conversion to a particular religion had taken place during the British period. While such conversions, while they have actually been able to give a bit of education and open hospital in the tribal areas, they are also responsible for alienation of the tribals from their culture. So we need to ensure is that tribals are not exploited by any kind of religious conversion, and we need to ensure that they are part of their original tribal religious beliefs. Relations between the tribals and non-tribals started worsening, and non-tribal residents were increasing depending on the protection of the some of the paramilitary forces in some insurgent areas. This is also an issue. In short, the main problems of the tribals are poverty, indebtedness, illiteracy, bondage, exploitation, disease, and unemployment. After independence, tribal problems and tribal unrest have become some kind of politicized. An articulate and effective political elite has emerged in several tribal areas. These elite are conscious, making calculated moves to gain their acceptance. The tribals of Jharkhand region in Bihar and Bastar region of Madhya Pradesh are recent examples where tribal political leaders have succeeded in compelling the central government to agree to form separate states. A separate tribal state in some of the states is also on the demand. Here, I would like to mention that the states like Madhya Pradesh have a separate tribal ministry for the specific purpose, and it is provisioned in the Constitution of India, as I mentioned initially, wherein it is important a need that a ministry separately takes care of the requirements of the tribals. It may be said that political culture of the tribes is undergoing a radical transformation. The parochial political culture and participant political culture is oriented more to sub-national tribal entities than to a broader national identity. So our job is to ensure that we bring the tribals under the broader national identity, rather than making them part of sub-national tribal identities. So these kind of efforts are very, very important in the long run to ensure, and I feel Think India is doing a right thing by trying to bring about a broader national perspective when it comes to the tribal identity. The current central government led by Shri Narendra Modi is continuously working on the upliftment of tribal population of India. The current government is focusing more on taking them to the even grounds. Recently, Union Minister for Petroleum and Natural Gas, Dharmendra Pradhan, said financial assistance of 1,656 crores has been released by the central government to Odisha in the last years, 3 years, for empowerment of tribals and other vulnerable communities. Honorable Prime Minister is working relentlessly for the inclusive growth of tribal communities, and Union Tribal Affairs Minister lent his support to the state government to realize the full potential of the tribal communities. More than 16,700 students from the vulnerable sections of the states have been enrolled in the Ekalavya model residential schools during the above said period. Establishing premier residential schools to provide quality education to scheduled tribes and other tribes, especially in the remote and left-wing extremist affected areas, the Ekalavya model residential schools has been a game changer in strengthening education in low literacy districts. This is what we find. There is also an effort from the government of India to relentlessly create an ecosystem to enable the tribal population, especially in the majoritarian states, to realize their full potential and ensure their inclusive growth, development, and prosperity. Here, I would like to mention that whatever social, cultural, political, and other rights have been safeguarded in the Constitution, it becomes very important for all of us to understand that we need to create an atmosphere for the overall growth and realization of the fullest potential of the tribals in India. We are a country which has one of the richest culture as far as the tribals are concerned. And it is a great pride for us that this culture needs to be protected, not only protected, but we need to ensure how we can create a positive climate and atmosphere for the tribals to actually come up and occupy their constitutionally provided provision in the society. I think I'm very sure that all of us together will work in that direction, and Think India will also make such efforts, and an effort of this kind will also ensure that we are all going in the right direction. This is what I have to say in at this point of time. The moderator can.
Thank you so much, sir, for such an elaborate insight into the various constitutional provisions that exist, the problems that the administration faces while implementation, and most importantly, the issue of identity. Now I would like to ask certain questions that were submitted by the participants of today's session. One question that was repeatedly asked is that denial of rights to the young people of these tribal communities often leads them to join certain separatist organizations. So how can we curb this activity, how to provide them employment opportunities, and how to skill them?
I would like to mention here that it's a very important question, and I myself, being the district collector, as I mentioned about Singrauli, one district where we had predominantly, it was a tribal district in nature. And it was very close to the Chhattisgarh Naxal affected districts, extremist areas affected districts. So the important thing is the administration, the administrators, whether it is a political executive or the permanent executive, need to be very close to the tribals. Like what I used to do as district collector was, we have this thing wherein the state government tells that all the collectors, all the district officers have to do night stay in the rural areas. So I used to make it a point that I always stayed in the predominantly tribal villages. I used to stay in their in the hostels, tribal hostels, in the gram panchayats of the tribals. This enabled interaction with the tribals and a feeling of togetherness, a feeling that the entire administration is with the tribals. And when we spend time with the tribals, we come to know about a number of issues they are facing, whether it is an issue pertaining to infrastructure, education, health, or otherwise. So absence of governance and administration in the tribal areas leads to youth feeling that the government is not with us, the government is not part of us, and that is when they feel alienated and they go and join some organization which is not appropriate. So the job of the government is to ensure that the governance is seen sitting with the tribals. So the government, members of the government, whether it is the political or the non-political administration, executive, should go and spend time with the tribals.
Thank you, sir. There's one more question related to sustainable development. Nowadays, as you also mentioned in between, that lot of development projects take place and that results into illegal encroachment and destruction of forest land of the tribals. So what kind of policies should be devised so that we have sustainable development, that tribals also get enough employment opportunities as well as their culture and their land gets protected?
See, one of the some of the major steps that have been taken by government, state government and government of India, I would like to mention is the Forest Rights Act. Forest Rights Act is one of the most important legislations that government of India came up. And apart from that, the Land Acquisition Act of 2013 and 2014. These are the acts which have created a positive feeling amongst the tribals. And I mentioned to you that land alienation of natural resources from the tribals has come down a lot after these acts came into existence. Apart from that, after 2014, the new government which came into existence brought about a new Mines and Minerals Act, wherein the new Mines and Minerals Act enables that whatever mining and minerals are actually taken out from the areas where tribals are living, a portion of that will go for the development of the infrastructure of that particular area. And these kind of initiatives, I would say, are creating very important and positive feeling amongst the tribals. So sustainable development comes into picture with ensuring that these acts are actually implemented in toto in the tribal areas of our India.
Yes. And so one more question that was asked is about the identity. As you also mentioned that there are mass convergence taking place, probably forced convergence taking place. And even the people living in cities and villages are unaware about the rich heritage and the assimilation that was there in ancient India between the people living in the forest, the Vanvasis and the kings that ruled that particular region, and also the contribution of the tribal people towards that particular state. So what efforts should be taken by the government, by the students also, to ensure that all of us take a sense of pride in our tribal culture of Bharat?
See, this is a very, very important area which has only now that we are recently seeing there are certain positive developments actually happening. It was very unfortunate that many a number of governments actually closed their eyes when it comes to the issue pertaining to conversion. Here we have to be very clear that the tribals are one of the most rich people in the entire country, in the world. If you go to any part of the world, tribals have the best kind of customs and traditions and simple living. It is simple living with rich culture. And their cultural values can be protected if they are allowed to live the way they are. Any interference by any outside agencies or religions, as mentioned, you know, by kind of conversions, will only take away their originality from them. And we will be doing gross injustice by taking away their originality. Nobody should take away any original way of life of anybody. So this is where I would say any the members who are listening to me who are part of this, please go and spend time with the tribals. If you spend time, energy, you will know how rich their culture is, how traditional their values are, and how important it is to learn from the kind of their life. We have complicated our lives by building a very complex system. Their life is very simple. If we have to, even if we have to actually simplify our lives, we better learn from the tribals. So the best way is, I always say, is please, if you have holidays, go and spend 1 week to 10 days with them. Live with them. Live in their villages. And you will be having one of the best experiences of your lives when you spend time with them.
Thank you. I think that's a very important takeaway. We have one more question. Arnav Hardas is asking that some tribal people are often considered as anti-government and ignore the policies of the Indian government and their help. So many a times they have an anti-government approach. They do not trust the government. So what, according to you, can be done to resolve this issue?
See, I will again repeatedly mention to everyone is that who considers whom anti-government or anti-Indian is an issue which crops up when there is an absence of governance or misinformation or misguided set of people actually become part of the society. And who are they? How did they become misguided set of people? Is because the government has not reached up to them. And when government has not reached up to them, somebody else actually reached up to them. So the only way to ensure that these set of activities don't happen or these things don't happen is the administration and the government has to reach out to such set of people, sit with them, understand them, resolve their issues. And that is when we will see that there is nobody of that kind or there is no such issue of that kind.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. I'm sure that this was a very insightful talk. A lot of people who are maybe IAS aspirants also look up to you for the kind of work that you have been doing. Now I would request Devika Deshpande to deliver the vote of thanks. Devika, are you here? Okay, I think she is not here. I'll end this talk. Devika? Okay, I thank you, sir, on behalf of Think India Travel Rights Forum. Participants, please unmute yourself. Someone.
Mrinmayee, unmute yourself, please.
Yeah, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir, for taking out time today and coming here to share your experiences and your knowledge with all of us. A lot of people look up to you. You are a youth icon, especially for the IAS aspirants. And I'm sure that whatever you have shared today, people take it take that with them home and try and live in some of the tribal areas as you mentioned. I would also like to thank all the participants who joined today and who made the session wonderful with their questions. And we look forward to meeting you all in the next session of the Ekalavya series. Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I have shared my social media and email accounts. If somebody wants to actually know further, or want to get connected or want to understand things further, I'm always available. Thank you once again to each one of you. Bye. Good day.
Good day, sir.